Please begin.
Good evening, sir. Today's interview. So today we have with us Mr. Bhumesh Verma, sir. Sir is a managing partner of Cope Common League, an independent law firm. Sir had been a part of many law firms, and over the experience over 2 decades, sir had been one of the leading Indian senior partners. He has been ranked A in the top 100 lawyers in India. He has been expert in the field of domestic foreign claims. Beside of his busy work life, sir has also contributed many journals to many various law firms. Sir has also been invited to many prestigious law colleges and universities to be honored to share his knowledge for the upcoming lawyers. We are so honored to have you, sir. We welcome you, sir. Today, sir will discuss about the importance of drafting skills in a legal career. I request the participants to keep their mics and videos on mute. If anyone has any query or questions, you can raise your hand. We shall recognize you and unmute you, or else you can write it in the chat box, which will be answered at the end of the session. Without delaying any further, let's begin the session today. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Shivani and Law Internships, for organizing this very useful and interesting session on the importance of drafting skills. Now, the perceptions about legal drafting are very uncomplimentary, to say the least. Everyone assumes that legal drafting is very boring, very complicated, very flowery language, very difficult, and so on and so forth. It is perceived to be a lawyer-to-lawyer communication. That is, no layman can read or understand what is written in legal pleadings, contracts, and otherwise. Now, these are the perceptions, like the legendary actor Will Rogers once said, the minute you read something and you cannot understand it, be sure that it was written by a lawyer. Or Fred Rodel, he said, there are only 2 things wrong with almost all legal writing. Only 2 things. One is the style and the other is the content. So this is the perception about legal drafting. Do the participants agree with this? Say, for example, Shivani, do you agree with this?
Sometimes.
Right? So everyone assumes legal drafting is very difficult to understand. No one can make anything out of it, heads or tails, right? But today we will just discuss very briefly what is drafting. What is good drafting? What is effective drafting? What steps or process can we undertake to make it good and effective writing? What is the importance of this writing skill? Now, what is drafting? Would any student say anything about it as to what is assumed, what is understood by the term drafting? What is drafting? Speak up. I guess one of you speak up, that will expedite the process.
Students, you can unmute yourself to answer.
Because unless we know what is drafting, how can we improvise on it? How can we make it better?
Sir, drafting includes drafting of particular contract or drafting a legal notice, or it can include drafting advice notice to your client.
Right. So we are not talking as to how many kinds of drafting are there, right? Even if you are doing your homework, that is a drafting, right? You are appearing in your exam, you are drafting your answers, isn't it? What is drafting? This is what we are trying to understand. To me, drafting is writing first, right? Secondly, in legal profession, drafting, you think like it's an encapsulation of the brief that has been provided to you by the client. You read the client's brief, written or oral. You understand it. You encapsulate your thought process on it in words. This is what drafting is, right? What is the idea of drafting? The idea is to convey the feelings, the submissions of our client and put it across to the other party. Who will be the other party here? The other party could be another, say, company or individual with whom our client wants to engage in a contract. It could be a judge. It could be an arbitrator. It could be a regulatory body. It could be the government of India. It could be anyone. And what do we do through this drafting? Most of the times, we either raise a claim on behalf of our client, or sometimes we are supposed to defend our client when a claim has been made against our client, right? So this is what essentially, basically, fundamentally, simply put, drafting is. Drafting is writing, putting your thoughts in words to convey to the other party as to what your point is. That is drafting. Now, the next question arises, I mean, from a law student's perspective, I think all of you would be law students as of now, most of you at least. Do you think drafting is an easy process, or drafting is a complicated or difficult process? What is the perception among law students?
Sir, according to me, it can be an easy process if a proper skill and knowledge is there. If you are having a proper research on a particular topic and you are able to know the problem and the solution, and you are able to write it in your own language with legal term, it is an easy process, but it comes with practice and experience.
Mm-hmm. Now, what is there in drafting as of now? These days, you get templates for everything, isn't it? You can get it within your database, your friend's database, your college database, Google, any books, and so on and so forth. 99 or even more percent of drafting today would be taking place with the help of templates, right? So, drafting. It should be an easy process. What say?
Yes, sir.
It is an easy process. Why do you think it is intricate or difficult?
But sir, not in every case, I think so.
What if we were to talk contrarian now? In my experience of last 30 years, 3 years as a law student and 27 years as a practitioner, almost 30 years, drafting is the most difficult and scariest legal assignment that you can get. Because whatever goes in your name, whether in the court, whether in a contract, whether in a legal notice, bears your name, your stamp. Anything that is wrong in that, be it law, be it facts, be it style, be it intent, be it content, anything that is wrong that has gone in your name, the blame lies on you. Irrespective of where did you get the template from? You got the template from a colleague or from one of the top 5 law firms or one of the top 10 international law firms or whichever legal luminary's book, they are not going to share the blame. The blame lies with you. Whatever is wrong. Now tell me, Jashan.
Yes, sir.
Is it simple or is it difficult?
It is difficult, sir, because when you are making specially contract for a client, you need to think and research 10 times. It is difficult.
Anything that goes in your name, in court, in contract, in notice, in anything that has gone out of your, you know, out box is your responsibility. In American terminology, we call it the buck stops here. You cannot blame anyone for any mistakes in your drafting. You cannot say, I took a template from this book or from this top tier law firm or this university or Google or anyone. The client has not engaged this other law firm or this other lawyer or this university or this author or Google for that matter.
So?
Yes.
Megha Jain wrote, if the blame comes on the name, what are the repercussions?
When it comes to you, we will discuss it then. It is very premature right now. First, let us discuss what is the importance of drafting skills. Then we can speak of implications later on in maybe some later sessions. Right, sir, now, this stage is too premature, I'd say.
Kasturi asked, sir, I think it is difficult in the beginning.
Yes. Okay.
Sure, sir.
So drafting is the scariest exercise that you can get, scariest assignment that you will get ever in your life. You have to be careful with everything that is there in your draft. Whatever you are drafting in your legal career, you have to be very careful because the blame lies on you. So in the next half an hour or so, we will discuss how to make it better, how to be careful. As a concept, drafting is the art of storytelling. You are crafting a story when you are drafting. And why am I saying that it is storytelling? If I tell you, take drafting as storytelling, what would you assume?
Sir,
you are writing a story. Yes, please.
Sir, it includes.
Discussed. Right, you are not creating this story for yourself. You are creating this story to sell it to someone. You have to I have written books. Okay. What if they don't sell? What is the use? Why would I write a book I would write a book to share my knowledge or experience, and I would expect others to benefit from it, right? If no one buys it, what is the point? My labor has gone waste, isn't it? So do not think of yourself as craftsman. Will buy it. If no one buys it, there is no benefit, neither to you as a professional nor to your client. If you are, because what happens in court on the same facts, say there's been a robbery, there's been a dacoity, there's been an accident, take any case, on the same facts, two sides or even more sides are trying to sell different stories to the judge. And who wins? Nandini, who wins? Who wins in the court?
Sir, your client.
Your client, always.
Yes, sir.
Devyani, what do you say? Who wins? Person with the best story. Meghna, not with the better story, person with the best story.
Yes, sir. Person with
more convincing story.
Yes. So what you have to do henceforth in your drafting is to make it very, very interesting, very, very convincing. You have to convince the judge. You have to convince the arbitrator. You have to convince the government authority, statutory bodies, United Nations, whomsoever you are dealing with. You have to convince all the other parties and stakeholders involved with your side of it, your narrative, so to say. So do not ever take drafting as an isolated, boring, dull exercise. It is storytelling. It has to be as close to reality as possible, as interesting as possible. Because unless your story is interesting, nobody will read it. Nobody will understand it. And nobody will appreciate it. So your client will not get the relief or the benefit that it is seeking. And what is it that you are doing as a professional throughout your life? You are not working for yourself. You are working for your client. Your client is the universe for you. Your client is the Annadata for you. So unless you are able to capture your client's benefits, entitlements, you are not selling good stories. It means you need to improvise on your storytelling skills. Take it that way. So first aspect of drafting skills is the art of storyteller. You have to tell a story and you have to sell a story. Okay. Now, there are, you know, mostly I talk about contracts. So there are contracts and contracts and contracts. Or even if you extend it to the entire gamut of legal drafting, there are drafts and drafts and drafts and drafts. What is a good draft? What is a good pleading? What is a good contract? What is an effective draft? Would somebody throw some light on this? What, in your assessment, is a good draft? Yes, Sakshi, please. Yes, Diksha. Yes, Diksha.
So good drafting is it's something like sir, effect. So it's like effective drafting in which we communicate well.
right,
in which we can write everything in a chronological way, and whatever is important we don't miss out.
Right, very good, very good. Nandini.
Yes, sir. So I am just saying that good drafting or better drafting is a thing where you are conveying your thing a very simple and accurate manner.
Right. For me, the barometer for assessing whether your drafting is effective or not, you can take some, you know, cues. First and foremost, you have to safeguard your client. You have to protect your client. First aspect is protection. How do you do it? You do it by limiting your client's obligations, duties, any setbacks, any penalties, any exposures that your client may have, right? In the transaction or in the legal proceeding, you have to limit your client's exposure. Second aspect is, first is safeguarding, second is empowering, empowerment of your client. Your client has to be stronger after coming to you, right? So what do? You expand the scope of your client's rights, benefits, entitlements under the subject document, be it pleadings, be it contract, be it notice, whatever. And if you talk of, say, contracts, this whole system should work effectively from start to finish, right? A contract is, again, not a piece of paper. It is a very much living thing. Parties depend on it. Their factories depend on it. Their families depend on it. The entire economies depend on commercial contracts, right? So lives are affected by contracts. Similarly, lives are affected by pleadings, because they affect legal rights and obligations, even life and liberty of people. So unless you can secure the interests of your clients, you can safeguard them, or you can extend their powers, rights, benefits, entitlements, it is not effective. Right. So this is the crux of effective drafting, getting what your client needs, whether your client needs security or whether your client needs extension, empowerment of his rights, obligation, rights, benefits, entitlements, and so on. That is effective drafting. Securing the best for your client. And what is the need for effective drafting, if I may ask? What is the need for this entire exercise, effective drafting? Why are we emphasizing on effective drafting?
Because, sir, this will add a skill, and this will help our clients in their day-to-day business transaction and their work. A better skills of drafting would be, we would be able to generate or write contracts in a better way, so that it would be beneficial for both the parties who are entering into the contract, the better story perspective.
Right. Anyone else?
Also, it is important because it gives a proper structure to all the documents, and we can say it is a properly established or properly collective all the things in the one place.
Right. Good drafting makes a hell lot of difference. If I can use that term, the difference between good drafting and bad drafting could be jail or bail for the client. Life and liberty of your clients may depend on your drafting at times. Be very, very careful. And slightest of errors in your drafting may cost millions and billions of dollars to your client, and your clients may be saddled with so many unexpected obligations, legal implications, or if you're not careful enough, your clients may not have the rights that they may even be legally entitled to. Right? So your good drafting or bad drafting makes a lot of difference in your clients' lives, liberty, economy, so many aspects. Because most of the times, the clients may not be very sophisticated legal brains. They may be laymen or business-minded people. They may not have as much legal knowledge as you. This is what they come to you for. Otherwise, again, coming back to the same point, so many templates, millions of templates are floating on the internet. Why should a client come to you? Why should a client come to you? Customization is the key. The clients come to you first, expecting that you know better than them as far as their legal rights and obligations are concerned. Two, they expect that you will customize the pleadings or contracts as per their requirements, keeping them in focus, keeping them in mind, keeping their rights and obligations in mind. This is why the clients come to you. So unless you are capable of doing that, unless you are professional of doing that, you're not doing justice to your education, your educational institution, your profession, to humankind, anyone. So this is why precisely I keep saying drafting is scariest of assignments, and drafting is a lot of responsibility on your shoulders. So you have to be treading with caution all the time when you are drafting something. And the problem is that what the client expects, what the lawyer drafts, what the person supposed to implement that drafting, be it, say, in terms of a contract, these could be management people, these could be engineers, these could be architects, these could be HR manager, and so on and so forth, who would implement this contract. Or in case of pleadings, it could be judges, arbitrators, statutory bodies, government, your society, or, you know, RWA, so many stakeholders involved who are going to read, understand, and implement what you are saying. And just in case they are not able to implement it properly, how will the rights and obligations of parties, how will it be enforced? Enforcement will become the key. So there will be gaps at each stage. The client's expectations, your drafting, its implementation, and its enforcement. So unless you are careful with your drafting, there will be gaps at all stages. And they may become so wide that they can't be bridged. Sometimes things become irreversible. Like if you are supposed to clear this semester by July 31st, you have appeared in exams, you haven't cleared it. Can you bring the time back to 31st July 2021? Or you could not take the exam today for any, you know, mishap. Today it rained too much, or you did not get a cab, you could not reach the examination hall, you have not appeared for it today. Can you ever by any means pass this exam by 31st of July 2021? So as of now, you do not know what things may become irreparable damage to your client by your lousy drafting. This is why, you know, we keep coming back to the crux of effective drafting. Effective drafting is good drafting. This is why, you know, you have to start learning the traits for good drafting skills from as early in your career as possible, even from your student days. So now let's discuss a few aspects as to how to write effectively, how to draft effectively. Now, what is our conventional education system, not only legal education, but generally legal, the entire education system in India, that you write more and you get good marks, right? The longer your answers are, more marks you are likely to fetch. In drafting, you should take a contrarian stand, an opposite stand. You have to be a miser with words. You have to use as less words as possible. Try to cultivate work smart culture, not work hard necessarily, as far as your drafting is concerned. Write as less but most effective words. Convey what you want to say in as less words as possible. No point making a 500-page pleading which no one can humanly read, with millions of cases backlog in courts. Do you think any judge will have the time to read your 500-page pleading? Anyone who feels otherwise can tell here and now.
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir. No,
right? Sir. So, why are you writing a 500-page pleading? Write less, but write effective. Take words as your capital. Take words as your money. Do not waste it. Every word in your sentence should deserve its place. Do not overuse any word. Having said that, whatever you are drafting, incorporate everything that is relevant, that is required. I'm not saying for the sake of brevity, leave what is relevant, what is required. No, not that. But there should be nothing useless there. There should be nothing repetitive. Nothing should be there just to inflate the number of pages. Write concise, precise, be very particular, be very specific. It is called specific is terrific. Be specific, be up to date. Always keep all the legal amendments in mind, all the reenactments, repeal, latest case law, and so on and so forth. Always be up to date with legal developments. Your drafting should be crisp, clean, clear, understandable. And should be complete also. Do not leave any important aspect. Make it complete so that the need for any supplementary submissions is reduced as much as possible. And your writing style has to be consistent throughout the document. It should not be that it appears to be a khichdi, that you have taken some clauses from some petition, some clauses from another petition, and so on and so forth. So your bluff will be called out if the language and the style and the definitions are not consistent throughout. Do not go overboard to impress anyone in terms of the number of pages or language. Simplicity is the best sophistication. Keep it as simple as possible. Because you have to bear in mind, this legal drafting is not for your literary pleasure. This is to get for the client what the client wants. Drafting is for the benefit of the client. Drafting is not for your benefit or your literary pleasure or, your quest to impress anyone, your, counterpart lawyers or the judge or the arbitrator. Drafting is not for that. So do not get any sadistic pleasure out of your, legalese or jargon or flowery language and so on and so forth. If you can keep it simple, you can keep it short, but it conveys what you wanted to submit on behalf of your client. That is the best option that you have. That is what you do. You aspire to be. So what should our drafting do? Our drafting should make the client's life simpler, better. You should always take this concept of 2 ears and one mouth in mind, that we have to listen to a lot of things from a lot of people whenever we are drafting. Like in case of pleadings, you may get to hear from different officers of your client about a case, you know, from different strata of management. It could be a promoter, it could be a functional manager, it could be a laborer, right? You have to condense all of that and incorporate what is most beneficial for your client and put it across to the court accordingly. So your drafting should add value to the client. As I said earlier, your client should feel benefited after having come to you. It should not be that client knows more than you or better than you. The client has come to you because the client thinks, at least thinks, you know better than him. So your drafting should be clean, clear, crisp, understandable, not like a doctor's prescription that, you know, only doctors and pharmacists can decipher. Keep it as simple as possible. Now, coming to templates, or what we call precedents, drafts. We have, unfortunately, a culture of blind cut, copy, paste. You get a template, you copy it in your computer, just change few particulars, names of the parties, dates, name of the court, and so on and so forth, and think your job is done. That is, again, a very scary proposition. You may be compromising your client's case. Unless you read, review, and negotiate it completely. So do not rely on Google blindly. That is the first thing. Second thing is, do not think what you think is important is most important. Other things are not important. In case of pleadings, a problem could arise out of anywhere in your submission. Same happens with contracts. A dispute could arise out of anywhere in the contract. Not only the operative clauses, but even boilerplate clauses, standard terms and conditions. So you have to read everything completely, see what is there in this template, and then assess what out of it should remain there. What should be discarded from this draft? What should be there, but some corrections need to be made? You know, there could be some legal updates or something wrong in the submissions in the template that you are working on, or the earlier pleading or contract may have been drafted from a different party's perspective. Like, say, if you are drafting a contract on behalf of an investor, you get hold of a template and you just make some cursory changes in that and you think your job is done. But what if that draft was there, you know, crafted on behalf of the investor? It will be loaded in favor of the investing company. So aren't you compromising your client's interest? So even if you get hold of a good template, you need to read it word by word to assess whether it applies to your client's case, whether it is beneficial for your client, or are you compromising with your client's interest? So this is how you should work on templates. And you have to be a wordsmith if you want to be a good, you know, draftsman, a good storyteller. Now tell me something. Do we start reading first or writing first? In our lives, do we start reading first or writing first?
Sir, reading.
Reading.
Reading?
Okay. Reading. So,
reading. How can you start drafting unless you read? Am I correct?
Yes.
You cannot become a good storyteller, a good draftsman, unless you read, unless your vocabulary is good. So what should law students and young lawyers read to become, you know, better in drafting? What should we people read? Any suggestions? What should we read?
Sir, contracts in the form of draft.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
Sir, law books.
Law books. Very good, Arman.
The
Mishra
previous
says,
case laws.
Yes, Nandini. Sorry, I missed it.
The previous case laws.
Previous case laws. Yes, very good. What else?
So real agreement, contracts, and cases. Real, very good. Real ones.
Very good.
Sir, read the problem of client also.
Very good. Yes, indeed. Anyone else?
Sir, in my point of view, first the lawyer should analyze himself as the person in the story, and he has to analyze the facts, and then he can make a draft over it. So first of all, he has to analyze as him in the case, so that it would be easy to make the situation so better.
Right. Okay. Good. Now, you people have become lawyer or will become lawyer very soon, right? Were you born as a human, as a person, or as a lawyer?
As a person.
As a person.
As a person.
As a person. Right. So you have a life, right? You are not born to be a lawyer and live like a lawyer all the time, right? So as far as reading is concerned, read everything. Do not confine yourself to legal reading. Get a life. Don't be a boring person. Don't be a legal nerd. Is anyone following me on LinkedIn?
No, sir.
Yes, sir, I'm following, sir.
Sir.
Are all my posts on legal subjects?
No, sir. No, sir.
No? What are, what all do I put?
Sir, posts current on? Events, current events as well, and practical knowledge about life, like those things you post.
Even jokes, right?
No, yes, sir. Sometimes.
Right. So you are, don't be a legal nerd. Don't be, you know, someone whom everyone thinks is a very serious, very boring, very dull, very complicated person who knows only what to speak about law and cases and so on and so forth. Get a life beyond law. Be a normal person. Okay? You are not born to become a lawyer, work like a lawyer, live like a lawyer 24 hours a day and go to Shamshan Ghat. No, that is not. You've got this only one life. Enjoy it fully in all aspects. Read everything. That will enable you to understand the client's perspective. You have to know business. You have to know economy. You have to know politics. You have to know world affairs. You have to know environment. You have to know management. You have to know everything. If you have to become a trusted partner for your client, right? Only then you will grow in a hierarchy as far as, you know, being an associate, senior associate, partner, senior partner, managing partner, all these are concerned. If you know only law, but no management, no interpersonal skills, will you cut a good figure for yourself as a partner or as a managing partner in a firm?
No, sir.
Right? So to assume greater responsibilities in life, you should cultivate greater skills as well, diverse skills. So please read everything that you find interesting, be it sports, be it environment, be it politics, anything. Do not confine yourself to legal reading only. right? And there would be some difference always in the way why you draft for litigation and to draft for contracts. Like in pleadings, our idea is to win a case by emphasizing our point to the judge or the arbitrator, right? So some amount of repetition may creep in. It, sometimes, you know, if the other party has said same thing in 10 paragraphs in a notice, we'll have to respond in 10 paragraphs. Again, same thing, reverting the submissions of that party, right? So some element of repetition is very inherent. You cannot avoid it in litigation practice. But in corporate practice, parties are not fighting with each other. Parties have to collaborate. So an approach of give and take and balancing the rights and obligations of parties is inherent. There you can afford to be a miser with words. There you can write less and not be repetitive. Well, these are a few things I wanted to convey to you as an icebreaker as far as drafting skills are concerned. We'll be happy to answer any of your questions.
Sir, I just want to ask that how can we learn the drafting patterns and we can say a structure to draft?
Well, there are sufficient templates available, right? In your college curriculum or in the books that are available in the market or the online courses that are there on different kinds of drafting. You could take help from them. Because in these days, it will be very impractical to think that you will be typing out a pleading of, even say 20 pages, right? From word to word. You'll have to take help from some good template. You'll have to draw inspiration at least from somewhere. Yes, anyone else?
Sir, but what can be the best courses or best book that we should refer while doing drafting? Can you please guide it on that?
There is some problem with my internet connection. I may have missed your question, Jishan.
Sir, what would be the best book or courses that we should prefer for drafting, because everything is not relevant or is not reliable? What source we can...
Well, you have to judge for yourself. I mean, I cannot recommend something that will be like a conflict of interest for me, because even I am associated with the many online tech companies. So you better search and see what suits you the most and what aspect do you want to learn drafting in. Is it contracts or is it general legal drafting? Whether it suits your budget, whether the time frame is good, there are a lot of factors that you may need to consider.
Sir, actually I'm interested in corporate, so I need to learn related to the drafting related to corporate subjects. That's why I was asking.
Yes, so there are many courses offered by tech companies. I'll not take names. Just do a good research and check the feedback of other students and go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Sir, is it important to learn about legal research in order to be good at drafting?
Well, as I said, unless you read, you cannot write. So unless you research well and condense that information, how will you write, right? You have to rely on the client's brief and then you will research what cases, what legislations, what customs, what practices support my client's case. So a good research is inherent in good drafting. It is a precursor to your writing. It is a homework for your writing, right?
Yes, sir, understood.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
So I had a question, as in, sir, how to analyze if a particular template is a good or a bad template, as in how to look for a good template? What are the major things that we look for in a template that make it good?
Because about a contract or a pleading?
So like we talk about the legal notice format. A template that we get online, that there are a lot of formats that we get. So like, which one to choose is the question, sir.
Well, as I said, there are a lot of templates floating, but you have to see what suits my client's interest the most. So because it is your story, so you have to craft it as per your way. Your client's interest is paramount. So you see all the facts should be there, all the legal propositions should be there, all the demands that your client has from the other party should be captured. And the other party should be, I mean, if we can use that word, threatened enough to comply with what our client is asking. The other party should feel serious enough to comply with our, you know, averments. That is the key. So any template, any draft will do good if you capture all these things in your draft.
All right, sir. Thank you.
Yes, any other questions, or shall we wind up for today?
Sir, just a request as a law student. Sir, I've seen many times that you have given so many lessons on it. Just a request that if you conduct any course of drafting, or it would be really beneficial for us. Because, sir, we need a guidance, and many times it's happened that the courses that are available are not good for in a budget-wise. That's right. And guidance also.
Right. We keep conducting these in association with a lot of, I mean, 1 day, 2 day workshops in association with some organizations. And sometimes I just put it on LinkedIn. Even I hold it without aligning with any organization. It's like a 6 hour session on a Sunday. Last one we had on 25th of July, last Sunday only. And we take very few, 20, 25 serious people only. And this is why we keep nominal registration fees also. Free mein karenge toh, there will be like 1,000 people coming in, right? But we need only serious people. So you can check with the law internships. We can hold one in collaboration with them. Or otherwise, just keep checking my updates on LinkedIn.
Yes, sir.
So I guess everyone is done with the questions. Student, do you have any other questions you may ask, sir? Sir, I think they are all done.
Good. Thanks.
So further, I would like to move to the vote of thanks. On behalf of our team Law Internship, I would like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to you, sir. Thank you for taking time from a busy schedule and helping our young lawyers with their legal careers. We really appreciate that. And we're looking forward to have more session with you, sir.
Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure interacting with such young, ignited minds. Let's keep in touch. Thank you.
Sure, sir. Have a great day, sir.
Thank you so much for coming over here. It was a pleasure to have you on board. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.